Verse 3, the blessed Lord said, Brahman or the absolute is the indestructible, the supreme, higher than all else, essence of being that is manifest in all beings is called the self. Karma is a name given to efforts made to develop the lives of all creatures and to take them towards the light. The answers that Sri Krishna gives are just as concise as Arjuna's questions. In the first verse, Arjuna asked 5 questions and Sri Krishna gave 3 answers in this third verse. The first line of this verse answers Arjuna's first question. Arjuna's first question was, Kim tad Brahma? What is Brahman? Sri Krishna gave the answer that Brahman is the indestructible and the supreme, higher than all else. This is a very compact description from which you cannot even remove one word. It is such a clear definition. What is Brahman? God has said that Brahman is Aksharam Brahma Paramam, the indestructible and the supreme that is higher than all else. We will now go through the meaning of the word Aksharam, the indestructible, and Brahman is that as well as the supreme that is higher than all else. We hear the word Brahman, Brahman, Brahman a lot. But have we ever wondered what Brahman is? We want Brahmanan, the bliss of Brahman, Brahmasthiti, the state of Brahman, that Sri Krishna described in the second chapter, and Sachidanandan Brahman, Brahman that is existence, wisdom and bliss, etc. But what is Brahman? We must really understand what it means. Just like Socrates said that he would only show a person on the path of God once a person knows who God is, when we think about what Brahman is, then no matter how many discourses you listen to, it will be clear what the foundation is. What is Brahman? Paramam means the truth which is greater than anything else. Aksharam is a word worth thinking about. We can understand its meaning in 3 or 4 ways. We can break down the word Aksharam in 2 ways. The first is A and Ksharam. Ramanujacharya and Srimad Adishankaracharya have defined it in this way, Nashrati iti Aksharam. The A is negative and Kshar means destructible. Therefore Aksharam is something that cannot be destroyed. What is Brahman? It is that which is indestructible. It is not only indestructible, but also Paramam, and therefore greater than anything else that is indestructible. It is the greatest of all things that are indestructible. There is also another meaning of Aksharam, and that is something which is different from that which is destructible. Sharat Pinaha. Something can only be different from that which is destructible if it is indestructible. Something can only be different from white if it has no whiteness in it. In the same way, the scriptures say that something that is Aksharam is different from the destructible, and this means that it has no qualities of destructibility. That which has no element of destructibility is Aksharam. The second meaning of Aksharam is that which is beyond destructibility. Sharam Atipaha Akshara. It is something that destructibility cannot affect. If you go beyond something, then it cannot affect you. If a person is living on the ground floor, then mice and rats can come inside his house. But if this person leaves the ground floor and goes up to the first, second and third floors in a higher floor, then that person has gone beyond the ground floor and mice and rats cannot come up there. All these pets has reduced as you go up because you have gone beyond the ground floor, that is the level of the mice and rats. In the same way, that which is beyond destructibility is Aksharam, indestructible. Things that are destructible include events, the body, objects, circumstances, etc. All of these are destructible. That which is Aksharam, indestructible, is beyond all of this. The meaning of this is that the body is destructible, but I who am Aksharam, indestructible, am beyond the body. I am beyond this body. I am much above this body. I am different to this body. That is why destructibility does not affect that which is Aksharam, indestructible. This is what Brahman is. Third, we've already separated Aksharam as A and Kshara. We can also separate it as follows, Aksha and Ram. Devotees have given this a very beautiful definition. They say that Aksha means the eyes and Ram means beautiful. Therefore, Aksharam means that which looks beautiful to eyes. Aksharam is that universal form of God looking at which the eyes just stay there. We must understand the difference. We understood the definition of Aksharam as A and Kshara. This was of the formless God, whereas the definition of Aksha and Ram is of the form and the solitary truth becoming manifest with a form. The formless and the solitary truth becoming manifest with a form, moving in this world and residing in every atom in this world. One sees this truth in the world, and therefore aksharam can be split as a and kshara. One's eyes never stop looking at this form because it's so beautiful to look at. It is not different. It is beyond the others, and it is not different. In a Srimad Bhagavat, the gopis told Udhavji that the formless and solitary truth he is talking about can be seen every day by them. I will not go into the detail of the event. The gopi said that they could still hear the sound of his flute, and that same Kanaya, the name for Shri Krishna, comes and gives them water. The same Kanaya brings us back home from the jungle, and that same Kanaya steals milk and clarified butter from them. The gopis told Udhavji that he who is talking about is still there with them. This is aksharam. There are two forms of Brahman. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad says, Devavo Brahmano Rupe Murtam Cheva Murtam Amrutam Cha. There are two forms of Brahman, one that is manifested and one that is not manifested. The unmanifested Brahman is indestructible, but when it becomes manifest, then that looks beautiful to our eyes. Therefore, aksharam can be defined both in terms of the manifested form of Brahman and the non-manifested form of Brahman. If we combine both these definitions, then when Brahman is manifest, then that is beautiful to our eyes, whereas when Brahman is non-manifest, then that is indestructible. This is because only a form can be destroyed. That which is formless cannot be destroyed. We must understand this. The form is destroyed. The formless that is there inside the form can never be destroyed. For example, let us say that we have ice. If we heat the ice, then the solid block of ice will go away. The form has been destroyed. But the matter of water inside the ice did not get destroyed. The solid block of ice went away, but the water inside it did not. Then we heat it up even more. The water was there, but we heated it up and it turned the gas into steam. Now it cannot even be seen. But because it cannot be seen, does not mean that the water has been destroyed. No, the matter of water has just become steam and gas. The matter of water stays there, it does not go away. The form goes away, the form may get destroyed, and the form may be seen or unseen, and may even come back in the form of rain or hailstones. The formless truth residing inside this cannot be destroyed. Thinkers have said it very nicely, that a container can be destroyed, but the content cannot be destroyed. The form is only a container and only holds the current. It has nothing to do with the content. The container can be destroyed, but the content cannot be destroyed. Brahman is not the container, Brahman is a content. That is why it can never be destroyed. The senses can only see the form, but the formless truth inside the form cannot come within the reach of the senses. The senses cannot perceive it. This formless truth is Brahman. Scientists explain it beautifully that we are describing the transformation from ice to water and water to steam, but there must be a state in the middle when the ice does not remain and the water does not remain. This state in the middle is Brahman. This can be understood using different examples. Those who are comfortable driving will be able to understand this easily. When one is driving a manual car and going from first gear to second gear, or from the second gear to the third gear, then you have to press down the clutch because ideally the car cannot go directly from the first gear to the second gear, otherwise this tire would be ruined. One must go to neutral gear before changing from first gear to second gear so that the car can become free. The car can only become free in neutral gear. Then the car goes from first gear to the second gear and then the second gear to the third gear. Before going from first gear to second gear, one has to put the car in neutral gear. Before going from second gear to third gear, one has to put the car into neutral gear. This neutral gear is Brahman. Before going from one form to another one has to go into this neutral gear. Before going from one body to another body, one is still going to the neutral gear in the middle that we call death. Death is nothing other than neutral gear. Once again, you hold on to another gear, and this can be slower or faster than the other gears. Therefore, you have gone from one form to another form. This is Brahman. Therefore, look for the truth between the two forms. This is the Brahman. This is the Brahman. This truth in the middle is aksharam, indestructible. The form of the body has died, but can the movement between the two bodies ever die? This can never die. The body can die, but there is no death in a state between the two bodies. The reason for this is that there is no birth there either. The form is there. These are the two forms of Brahman. In the Gita, the word Brahman has been used with other meanings. For example, it has been described as Pranav, the Omkar. In the 8th chapter, we'll get a very beautiful description of the Omkar. We'll see what the Omkar is. Shri Krishna will explain it. The word Brahman has also been used for the meaning of the Omkar. The word Brahman has also been used in the meaning of the Vedas. Tamasutta Parishchaiva. The word Brahman has also been used within the meaning of Prakriti, nature. The word Brahman has been used in many different meanings in the Gita, but over here it is defined as Param, the supreme, that is higher than all else, and Akshar, indestructible. These are the two qualifications, and Brahman has been placed between these two. Param, the supreme, that is higher than all else, and Akshar, indestructible. By doing this, Shri Krishna is trying to make it clear that the Brahman over here is chief, supreme, higher than all else, Satchidanandan, existence, wisdom, bliss, indestructible, and the supreme truth. Therefore, the word Brahman used here is not the same as the Omkar, nature, the Vedas, as no other meaning is given other than the supreme soul and the supreme truth that is greater than anything else. That is what Brahman being expressed here means. Ramanujacharya gives a very beautiful description in his commentary that the Brahman is the indestructible that is greater than anything else, is the essential form of the self separated from nature. Paramam aksharam prakriti vina mukta atma sarupam. There are the two things, prakriti and purush. Prakriti is nature, purush is consciousness, and when they meet, then life begins and the body begins. If we take out prakriti, nature, then the pure form that is left is Brahman. This is the definition that Ramanujacharya gives. If we try to look at Brahman in one way, then it is indescribable because the person describing Brahman here is himself Brahman. Vedanti say it very nicely that the eyes see everything, but can the eyes see themselves? They cannot. In the same way, Brahman can describe everyone, but how can Brahman describe himself? The individual soul cannot describe himself or Brahman. Secondly, what are the means of knowledge from which we can get wisdom? First of all, we have the senses so that we can understand objects of words, touch, appearance, sound and smell. For example, if we see the form of a nice flower, then the eye see it and attains knowledge of the color of the flower and its leaves. These are the senses that we have. From the ears we get the knowledge of words. From the sense organ of the nose we get the knowledge of smell. From the tongue we get the knowledge of taste and by speaking words. From the skin we get the knowledge of touch. These are the senses or tools that we have. Secondly, we have the mind. The mind then begins to analyze all the information and data that our senses give us. The mind then makes its own assumptions. Third, we have the intellect, which makes decisions. We attain knowledge through these three things: the senses, the mind, and the intellect. These three means of knowledge are all matter. The tools of matter light up because of the consciousness of the soul. This is because it gives material strength to the senses. Can these material senses, the material mind and the material intellect, get knowledge of something that lights them up? If I were to give you a simple example, if there is petrol in the tank of a car and one feels as if the amount of petrol has reduced, because there is still some petrol in the tank, one can drive until a petrol station and fill up the car with petrol. The car is running because of petrol and the same car is going to get petrol. But if there was no petrol in the car, then how would this car run? I'm telling you the highest principle of Brahman. If something is not made by you, then this is because it has never been created. It is uncreated. My being, my nature, and myself is uncreated. It has never been created. This is because if it were created, then my pure being may have an end. If something is born, then it has to be destroyed. Therefore, my existence is not that of the body, but that of the soul. The soul is uncreated. The soul has never been created, and that is why it is immortal, undefeatable, and your own. We must think about this a little. If you think about it, great saints say that the 8th chapter of the Gita is a chapter that shows us how we should prepare for death. The two extremities of human life are birth and death. On the one hand, we prepare for birth, and on the other, it is not in our hands. We prepare for birth because all the karmas we do in this birth, or the karmas we may have done in our past births, can become sanchit or prarabdha karmas, and therefore reasons for our future births. In this way, we are preparing for our future births, but we cannot prepare for the actual moment of birth, because we do not know how we're going to be born, and this is outside of our hands. But the journey of life that takes place after one is born takes us to the next stop when we are floating on a boat in the lake of existence, and that is death. This is because after death, the next birth is going to take place, and one is going to go in a new body. In this journey of life, there is something that is in you, your mind, and all of our hands, and that is preparing for death. The importance of the occasion of death lies in the fact that everybody has to pass through death. Although the other occasions that we have in life happen to some people and not to others. For example, with the occasion of education, some people get education and some people do not get education. With the occasion of getting married, some people get married and some people do not get married. With the occasion of starting a business, some people start a business and some people do not start a business. With the occasion of living in the material world, some people live in the material world and some do not live in the material world. All of these things are optional. Guruji remembers that when he was studying, then the examination would come and it would say in the paper that the first question is compulsory and you only have to give answers to 5 of the remaining 8 questions. In the same way, in the examination of life, God has said that in other questions we can write about them in a way that we want, but the last question of death is compulsory. It's a compulsory question. Nobody can take an option on this question. Nobody can say that they do not want to answer that question or not to take the paper. This is not possible. I know that a lot of people prepare very well for the compulsory questions because people cannot take an option on them. However, in this journey of life, the compulsory question that we cannot give up is death, but how many people prepare for this? The 8th chapter of the Gita teaches us how we can prepare for death. It shows us the way that we should prepare for death, and the nature of this 8th chapter is very beautiful. Aksharam Parabrahman Yog, the yoga of the imperishable Brahman. It shows us how we can make an accession into the imperishable. It teaches us what Brahman is. Aksharam Parabrahma, Aksharam Brahma Paramam, the indestructible and the supreme that is higher than all else. In this verse, Shri Krishna then answers Arjuna's second question of what the self is by saying, Svabhava Adatma Muchyate. Essence of being is called the self. We should clarify that Svabhava is not what we call one's nature, such as being angry, dependable, stingy, etc. This is not what Svabhava is. The scriptures define the word Svabhava as meaning Svabhava Svabhavaha. Bhav comes from the word Bhu, and Bhu is to be. Therefore, the Svabhava is one's essence of being, and Svabhava is a self. Do we know who we are? If someone asks us who we are, then what is the answer we give? Somebody will say they're a doctor. Somebody will say they're an engineer. Somebody will say they're an accountant. Somebody will say they're a banker. Somebody will say they're a housewife or house husband. Somebody will say they're a mother. Somebody will say they're a father. We give all these identifications of ourselves. Who am I? My sense of being a doctor or my sense of being an engineer is not my sense of being. I am doing these things because I am performing the actions of a doctor. This is my doing, but it is not my being. If I am an accountant, then I draw up accounts, and these are my actions because I am doing the work of an accountant. Therefore, whenever somebody asks us what we are, then we do not give the answer of who we in reality are. We give the answer of what we do. The person is not asking us what we're doing. If somebody answers that they're a housewife, then this means that they're performing the work of a housewife. The person has not asked us what we're doing, but the person has asked us who we are. But the person asking the question does not even know that the answer he has got is wrong. This is because the person who asks the question has asked it for the reason of finding out what you do. And a person answering the question does not even know that he's giving the wrong answer. This is because he does not know who he is. True spiritual knowledge is knowing the Svabhava, one's essence of being, to know the self, to know the being and the experience of being. I like very much the 2 words that thinkers use of being and becoming. We are so busy and occupied with becoming that we have forgotten being. For example, we say we want to become rich, we want to become educated, we want to become big. Once I read a beautiful quote that when you want to become somebody, then you have to lose yourself and you have to go away from yourself. The more a person goes after becoming, then the more that the person goes further and further away from being. And the further the person goes away from Svabhava, one's essence of being. Search and find out who you are. Spirituality is nothing apart from this. Everything in spirituality is right, where there's talk of the soul, identification of the soul, and study of great scriptures. All of this is right, but why is all of this there? It is there to find out who you are. It is there to find out your being. I'll teach you a small experiment. In the morning, sit down and close your eyes and forget the limits, the boundaries, and the form of the body. Forget that you are the body, because the body has been changing. When you were born, then you may have been half a foot, and now after growing and growing, you may be 5'6". Now you start getting smaller and smaller again. When one is approaching death, then one's body gets smaller and smaller. When Guruji saw his grandmother after a long time, then he asked his grandmother why she had grown so small. His grandmother told him that she has not grown smaller, but her body is aging and getting wrinkled. This is what happens to the body with age. Forget about the body that is changeable and think about who you are. When you try to search for this, then you realize that you are not the form that you see in the mirror, because if the mirror was different, then the form you would see would also be different. When you go to the fair, then you see what they call laughing mirrors, where if you stand in front of one mirror, then you look very tall. When you stand in front of another mirror, then you look very short. And when you stand in front of another mirror, then you look very wide. In some mirrors, some parts of your body look big, and some parts look small. It all looks very funny and people laugh. In the same way, the material world is just like a fair. If you go and stand in front of some people, then you look very big. If you have two cars and another person does not have any cars, then you look so big when you stand in front of them. You think that this person does not have anything, and not even a cycle, whereas you have two cars. But when you go and stand in front of a person who has four cars, then you look extremely small. Just like the mirror in front of you keeps changing, in the same way, you keep changing. Is this your state of being, where if you stand in front of one person, then you look big, and when you stand in front of another person, then you look small? Is this your true form? Am I that? No. Then who are you? When all these mirrors fall away, then who are you? The clearer that this recognition you can give yourself, then you should consider that your spiritual conception is that much clearer. It is a question that can confuse you, and that is certain. But that is what spirituality is. You are not that which you are doing, but who are you in reality? The self is your essence of being. We have begun with ourselves and think about who we are, but ultimately, the Gita says here that one's essence of being is the self. In its common meaning, the scriptures that describe the soul are called Adhyatma Vidya, knowledge of the self. Svabhav means one's own essence of being and one's own existence. This is one's personal existence and one's own power. Why we say one's own? That when we say one's own, then whose is this? This is because when we put a hand forward and say me, then we're talking about the body. But here we're not talking about the power of the body, because the power of the body is not going to last. Then what does it mean to say one's own power? Whose own essence is this? The swa in svabhav means one's own self. Whose self is this? Srimad Adi Shankaracharya explains in his commentary that tasyaiva parasya brahmana pati devam pratyekatma bhavasvabhavasva bhavasvabhava adhyatman uchyate. A technical word is used, and this is pratyekatma. We must understand this. If you do a simple translation, they will show that svabhav is the essence of being of the Supreme Brahman residing in each and every body. This is the Supreme Brahman that we define above, which is indestructible and higher than all else. Let us try to analyze and understand this definition of svabhav. There are three phases. The highest phase at the top is the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul. What we are is what we understand in ordinary life as a Jivatma, the individual soul. But between the individual soul and the Supreme Soul, there is a phase and an intermediate stage, which is Pratyekatma. We'll go even deeper into this. The Pratyekatma is a phase in the middle. If you want to look at it in terms of stages, then Paramatma, Supreme Soul, is first, then there is the Pratyekatma, then there is the Jivatma, the individual soul. The Pratyekatma is the Svabhav, essence of being, and Adhyatma. The Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, is omnipresent, Sarvataragam. The Pratyekatma is a subtle and small part of the consciousness and the conscious strength of the omnipresent Paramatma, Supreme Soul. Between the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, and the Pratyekatma, there is a difference of quantity, not quality. If you use a pitcher to take some water out of the river Ganga, then the water in the pitcher is the water from the Ganga. But the Ganga has hundreds of thousands of gallons of water, whereas the pitcher only has half a liter of water. Yet, it is still the water of the Ganga. In the same way, the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, is omnipresent and is in each and every place, and out of this, a small and subtle part is a Pratyekatma. This Pratyekatma, which is a subtle part, and what we describe in other terminology as Purush, consciousness, meets Prakriti, nature. Our scriptures have shown us what happens when Purush, consciousness, and Prakriti, the five gross elements of earth, water, fire, wind, and ether meet, how the life is born out of this. This is the meaning of it. Therefore, Purush, consciousness, and Prakriti, the five gross elements, meet, and this body is created. This Pratyekatma, that is a part of the Paramatma, Supreme Soul, begins to form an Ahamkar, ego. Ahamkar comes from the words aham, meaning me, and kar, meaning ness. And therefore, it literally means manness. When the Pratyekatma forms an Ahamkar, ego, it becomes a Jivatma, an individual soul. Therefore, the Pratyekatma came out as a subtle part of the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, and the Pratyekatma is qualitatively just like the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, because it is without qualities, solitary and formless, and has no expectations, nothing is attached to it, and nothing touches it. But when this Pratyekatma gets an ego, then the five gross elements come together, and this body is created. When this Pratyekatma with an Ahamkar ego sits in the body, then it is known as a Jivatma, individual soul. The root of the Pratyekatma is in the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, and that is why, on the majority of occasions, we just talk about the Jivatma, the individual soul, and the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, or us and God. But now we are talking about metaphysics, philosophy, and Akshara Parabrahman Yoga, the yoga of the imperishable Brahman. When Shri Krishna talks about Svabhava, the essence of being, this Svabhava, the essence of being, is a Pratyekatma. This is because if there is any feeling of being separate from the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, or if there is any sense of duality between one and the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, then during this time, your pure form is that of the Pratyekatma. This is because the ego is just a bunch of rubbish that has crept into it. Then everything else that depends is also rubbish and also has come into this. The Pratyekatma is your Svabhav, the essence of being. Therefore, if you wish to place it mathematically, then Pratyekatma plus the ego plus the ling there, the physical body, equals the Jivatma, the individual soul. The scriptures say that the ling there, the physical body, is made up of the five senses of knowledge, the five senses of action, the five breaths, the mind, and the intellect. When these 17 pieces of matter meet, then there is the ling there, the physical body. When all these ingredients are put together, then you get the Jivatma, the individual soul. If I were to say in other words, then that energy with which the individual soul, the Jivatma, works, is the Pratyekatma. This is the Svabhav, essence of being, and this is the Adhyatma, the self. If I'm not forgetting, that Dr. Radhakrishnan has written very nicely in his commentary of the Gita that it is the phase of the divine that constitutes the individual self. The Paramatma is the Supreme Self, whereas the Jivatma is the individual self. The Pratyekatma is the phase of the divine that constitutes the individual self. It is divine, and of course it is divine. That is why you can see that the greatest understanding of the self and the best realization of spirituality is Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. This is because you who are the Pratyekatma are also the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, in the same form. That is why this is the peak of spirituality. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. For Srila Swami, Svabhav, the essence of being, meant something similar to what Shankaracharya said. Srila Swami defined the Svabhav, the essence of being, as a subtle part of the Supreme Being that has fallen into life. Svasya eva brahman eva anchayata jivarupena bhavanam svabhavaha. And adatma, as the Pratyekatma that enters the body and gains a right to the body and becomes the enjoyer of bodily enjoyments. Sa eva atmanam deham ajikrutya bhutvena vatmana adhyatma shabdena uchyate. Fourth, adi means above. We must understand the meaning of the word adi as four times later the meaning, the word will come. It will come as part of other words. For example, adhyatma, the self, adhibhuta, the basis of created being, the basis of created things, adhideva, the basis of the divine elements, and adhiyagna, the basis of sacrifice. Adi means above, and adhyatma, the self, is that which is above the antakaran, the inner being, the internal senses. The antakaran, internal senses, is four things: the mind, the intellect, the subconscious, and the ego. That which is above these four things is the adhyatma, the self. So bhav means the essence of being Brahman. If we look at it grammatically, then if the prefix adi comes before any word, then it becomes the internal residence and becomes about that word. Therefore, the word adhyatma can mean the weapon that demonstrates the one soul being everywhere. I am the single soul. The soul that is sitting here writing, giving this discourse, also the same soul is sitting amongst the listeners and residing everywhere. The supreme truth has become small and travels everywhere. Therefore, the three stages, the Paramatma, the supreme soul, the Pratikatma, and the Jivatma, the individual soul. So bhav is understanding this and understanding a form without the body. So bhav is that which is not made by me and that which is uncreated. Many people say that their anger is not made by them and has been passed on to them from their fathers and their grandfathers. People say that their fathers were angry and their grandfathers were angry and therefore they have to get angry. Some people say that their grandfathers hit them with pots and it hurt them. They describe it. They say that this is in the blood. This is not so bhav because it is created by you. You may not know that it is created by you, but it is created by you. Ask a social scientist and they will tell you that that which you think has been passed down from generations is actually not in your blood. It is an imitative knowledge. When a young child sees its grandfather getting angry, then the young child will think that you should get angry. In houses where there is a habit of speaking fast, everybody in the house would speak fast and nobody in the house will have a habit of speaking slowly. Does this mean that it's in the blood? No. If you had put that child in another house from day one, that child may start speaking slowly. It will not get back in angry. So bhav is silence. Words are not so bhav. Language is not so bhav. Silence is the bhav. Therefore, everyone can have different languages, but silence is the same in everybody. Being separate is not so bhav, but being together is so bhav. Language is not so bhav, but silence is so bhav. That is why we do not call language an accomplishment or penance, but we do call silence accomplishment and a penance. If you want to return to yourself, then be silent. Up until now, nobody has attained their self by talking and talking. All those who have attained their self have done so by leaving the words. Only they have reached the bhav. I'm saying this because a lot of us have the habit of saying that the body and swabhav go together. It's not like that. It takes a great man or woman to change his swabhav, because the swabhav that is really there is pure and beautiful. Swabhav is first that which is uncreated and something that you have not created. Secondly, swabhav is unconditional. It is not dependent upon conditions. This is swabhav. If a person gets angry because someone does something to him, then this becomes a condition. This person will get angry if the other person does something, or this person will get angry if the other person does not do as he says. All of these are conditions. This is not our swabhav, because swabhav is unconditional. We should attain this and understand this. The question of who am I is very much worth thinking about. The great saints of the Zen tradition say, find out your original face. The entire Zen way of thinking has been created based on this one sentence from the Gita, Svabhav Adhyatma. The self is the essence of being. Find out who you are. The tea ceremony in the Zen tradition is often described, and those who have studied Zen philosophy will know all about this. The tea ceremony is a very famous ritual in Zen tradition. They just drink tea. If you go to any Zen master for the first time and you tell them you wish to find out what Zen is, then or that you want to walk on the path of Zen, then they will just tell you to drink tea. The tea is not a half cup that you find in a market. This process of creating and this whole method is a whole method and a whole activity. The process of making the tea can last for 4 hours. The Zen masters are sitting in a room. They have about 8 to 10 pupils. Zen masters do not gather too many pupils around them. They're sitting in a circle, and in the middle there is a stove on which the water gets put. It's heated slowly and the tea is boiling. The master only says that the pupils should watch the tea being made. The master tells the pupils to just think about the tea. The pupils watch the tea boiling and drink the tea. The master tells them to be involved with the tea. Slowly and slowly, the tea gets heated for half an hour, 1.5 hours, or 2 hours. The tea becomes ready, and each of them slowly pour the tea in their cups, drop by drop. They drink the tea by just tapping the cup against their lips. They enjoy each and every particle of the tea. This tea ceremony goes on for 4 hours, is an activity of dhyan, meditation. The word Zen has come from the word dhyan, meditation. It is an activity of dhyan, meditation. What happens that after thinking and thinking about tea, the person doesn't even know when he has begun thinking about himself. This is because as soon as you become silent, and as soon as you begin inspecting your inner self, your faults and your deformities, and everything that is inside you will begin to come out. A list of these things will immediately be made. Such a person can do nothing but go on the right path. Many people amongst us have forgotten about the essence of their self. The bigger the amount we have forgotten about the essence of ourself, then the bigger the amount that we have gone further away from the self. The third thing that Sri Krishna explains in this third verse is that karma is the creative force that brings beings into existence. Arjuna's first question was that what is Brahman? And Sri Krishna gave the answer that the absolute that is indestructible, the supreme that is higher than all else. Arjuna's second question was what is the self? And Sri Krishna gave the answer that the self is the essential nature of being. Arjuna's third question was what is karma? And Sri Krishna is giving the answer that karma is the creative force that brings beings into existence. Keep the book with you because the Sanskrit language and the Sanskrit that Sri Krishna uses in the Gita is so thrilling. We think that performing karma means eating, drinking, walking around, etc. We say that if someone performs an action, then karmas are being done. If you wake up in the morning, brush your teeth, have a bath, put your clothes on, pick up the telephone, read the newspaper, or watch television, then we say that you have performed karmas. No. Sri Krishna says that karmas are the creative force that brings beings into existence. Sri Krishna uses the word bhut, meaning everything that is created, and not ghost, which is its meaning in Gujarati. We are all bhut. I am bhut, and you are also bhut. This is because we have all been created. That which is created and that which is born is bhut. All creatures, the word bhut came from the word bhava, meaning to be. Whatever there is all bhut. All creatures are bhut. Bhava means home, as we saw in the definition of swabhava. Bhuta bhava means the being of all creatures, the being of everything, and the being of all creation. Then Sri Krishna said, Udbhava kara. We think that Udbhava means to become manifest or to become born. In reality, the meaning of Udbhava can be found by splitting the word into Ud, meaning above and the highest, and Bhava, to become. Kara means to do or the activity. Therefore, Udbhava kara is used after Bhuta bhava, the beings of all creatures, to mean that the activity of raising and developing the being of all creatures. This is so beautifully described by Sri Krishna to show that karma can only be called the activity of making the lives of all creatures great and taking them towards a higher path. Karma is not eating, drinking, having a bath, etc. Does that which we call karma lead to the life of any creature being taken towards a higher direction? Have we done something like this? We beside other creatures, have we done something that leads our lives to a higher direction? Only then can we call them karmas according to Sri Krishna's language. Have we done something from which our being and our life has gone towards a higher direction or has developed? If so, then it is karma. How should we perform karmas? Sri Krishna has placed a word in the middle, visarga. What is visarga? Visarga has many meanings. Sri Krishna is trying to say that the activity of taking the lives of creatures in a higher direction is called karma, and because Sri Krishna has placed the word visarga before karma, Sri Krishna is trying to make clear that this activity must be in the form of visarga. Visarga means to send forth. Visarga also means to make efforts. Visarga also means to give up. It also means to give donations. It also means to surrender. Ravi Shankar Maharaj has written a commentary of the Gita in a very simple language called Gita Bodhvani. It is written as if it is being explained to people living in the villages. Ravi Shankar Maharaj says, while defining the word visarga, that it is giving up with full understanding and with thorough knowledge. Vivek Purvak Vidhi Pursanga Tyag. Therefore, it is not something that happens when one comes and gives you 4 or 5 compliments. It is through full understanding. It's not as if you have thrown 2,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees somewhere. It is through full knowledge. It is something that is done with protocols and decorums. Therefore, visarga means to donate or to surrender. Another meaning of visarga is to create or to prepare. Visarga also means to become liberated. It also means to light up. All of these are the meanings of visarga. If we try to combine all the meanings together, and through Sri Krishna's perspective, we can get a clear form of karma, that karma is to inspire people to take the lives of creatures towards a higher level. This is the case of all creatures, because Buddha Bhava Bhava Karo is very total. As the meanings of visarga change, in the same way, our ideas of karmas become more total. Karma is inspiring creatures to take their lives towards a higher direction. Karmas are making efforts to improve the lives of creatures. Karma is giving donations, surrendering something or giving up something so that the lives of creatures can develop. Karma is preparing so that the lives of creatures can go towards a higher level. By preparation, I mean to launch a project, to gather equipment for this, to gather manpower, money power, or any other things that are needed. All of these things are needed, and collecting all of these things is karma. The important word for this is for the development in the lives of human beings and other creatures. Development is an important word. It is a feeling that everybody in the world should develop towards a higher level. Sahana bhavatu sana punaktu shanir parvavahai. We will all enjoy it together. It is for every creature. Dharma is attaining liberation, cutting bondages, and breaking bondages in order to develop the lives of all creatures. Karma is destroying patantrata, bonds, and pradin panu, superstitions. Karma is showing the path of light for the development of the lives of all creatures. A rishi has said, asato ma sat gamaya, tamo dharma jyoti gamaya, mrityo ma amrutam gamaya, om shanti shanti shanti. Lead me from falsity to truth. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from death to immortality. Peace be, peace be, peace be. We do not want darkness, but we want God to take us out from the darkness and towards the light. Only then will there be peace in our lives. That mantra was from the Bhadanyak Upanishad. Karma is that which takes us and others towards light. The Supreme Soul has given a very clear definition of karma over here. One who has gone far away from himself should be brought closer to himself. Then when one is steady in his essence of being, then the activity of taking society towards a higher direction is karma. God spoke about being first and then doing afterwards. While oneself does not become clear, then karma does not have much of a meaning. Once the essence of being becomes steady and becomes clear, then the clarity of karma comes by itself. When one realizes who she is, then she immediately realizes what she has to do. Just like in offices, one realizes that he's a typist, then he knows that he has to do typing. If one is a typist, then this means that he's not a managing director and therefore he cannot sign a check as a managing director. And if he does sign a check, then the check will come back. When the answer to this question, who am I, becomes clear, then the answer to the question, what do I have to do, becomes clear on its own. If one knows that he's a typist, then he knows that he does not have to sit down and make tea, and if he sits down to make tea all the time, then there will be no meaning in him being a typist. One knows that he's a typist and not a tea man. One knows he's a typist and not a manager. When it becomes clear to one who he is, then it becomes clear about what she has to do. When we look at society today, then all the turbulence that is there is because people do not know who they are, and yet they are still performing actions. Then what is the consequence of their actions? When people have no essence of being and are still doing this to people, then Sri Krishna says that they should understand being first. Only then will doing come after. Sri Krishna first spoke about the self and then about karma. These are very difficult topics to talk about, and therefore I'll keep clarifying them because they do not come up often. They are also the foundations of spirituality because we hear these words so many times. We hear these words more than any other words. If you go to any Dharmic discourse, then do you not hear these three words, Brahman, the self, and karma all the time? We hear these three words over and over again, but do we clearly know in our minds what they are? We think Brahman must be something high up there. We think that the self is in books somewhere, and we think that karma is something that other people are doing. This is what we all think, and therefore it is important for our lives that the meanings of all three of these words are clarified. Sri Krishna has described the meanings of all these three things in his third verse, and we will go over them again briefly. Brahman is that which is imperishable and supreme, higher than all else. The self is the essence of being that is manifest in all creatures. This will most easily be remembered if you think of Pratyekatma as applying to every soul. The essence of being of the Brahman that is imperishable becomes manifest in all beings, and this is the self. Karma is efforts made to develop the lives of all creatures and take them towards the light. Therefore, Brahman is indestructible, complete, beginningless and eternal, and a self that is the essence of being is a part of Brahman. This Brahma becomes Pratyekatma and therefore becomes manifest as Jivatma, the individual soul, and this manifestation is also beginningless. This is because we cannot give the answer to the question of when the Jivatma, the individual soul, came. The Jivatma, the individual soul, is just as beginningless as Brahman. Why is it beginningless? Because this is its essence of being. This is its personal essence of being. Just like Brahman is without beginning and eternal, the same way its essence of being is also without being and eternal. The Supreme Soul accepted this littleness and it has become transitional. When this littleness comes, then this littleness has to develop. For example, there is a mother. She is a fully progressed youth and she gives birth to a young child. At the time of birth, the weight of the child was 6 pounds or 7 pounds. Therefore, a 7-pound child was born from a 50-kilogram woman. The 7-pound child that was born and this littleness came, but the child has to develop because the child cannot remain at 7 pounds, and if it did, then there would be difficulties. The child must develop. In the same way, the Supreme Soul is our mother, as devotees say with a feeling of devotion, Lord, you are our mother and I've been born from you. This littleness has to develop. These efforts of development are karmas. While performing karmas, human beings think about whether they are developing out of them and whether they are growing out of them. These are karmas, and development should be such that the mother likes it. If the child gets older and develops to become the best smuggler in the world, then will the mother like it? This is development, and this is progress. The person is smuggling like nobody else has done before. Will the mother like this? No. One should develop, but the development should be such that the mother likes it. In the same way, the Pratyekatma thinks and the Jivatma thinks that I have come from the Supreme Soul and have become separated, therefore the karmas that I do for my development should be such that they will give bliss to my mother, they should be such that my Lord likes them. These are karmas. These efforts in order to develop oneself must be made because these efforts are also beginningless. This is because the whole activity of becoming manifest in the essence of Jivatma and after development in the end becoming steady with the essence of the Supreme Soul, this whole activity is beginningless. Nobody knows when it began and therefore the whole activity is beginningless. It has always been running. The universe is the Lord's great game. Lok avakti lila kevalyam nak ekti ek atki ramate. Why did God create the universe? Because he was alone and he did not like it, so others were created, and this divine game of the material world began. This whole activity has been running. Therefore, all of coming into the essence of creatures, descending into creatures and developing other creatures and donating to other creatures, all of this is beginningless. That is why karma is called beginningless. That is why Sri Krishna has given this definition of karma in the Gita. We say that karma is beginningless and the process of karma is always continuing. Why is this? This is because the essence of creatures is beginningless. The activity of creatures developing themselves is beginningless and everything that has to be donated or left in order for this development to take place is also beginningless. That is why karma is beginningless. The whole process of karma is beginningless. The activity of karma is perpetually continuing and it will always come.